have to believe in it.
To appease public opinion, Putin announces that the submariners' bodies will be brought to the surface. The Norwegian branch of Halliburton, formerly directed by Dick Cheney, is chosen to carry out the operation.
Удалось обнаружить и поднять на поверхность тела четырех подводников. Один из них опознан. Это командир турбинной группы Колесников.
Но там были обнаружены три записки. Две из них – это записка Колесникова и записка Садиленко. Они датированы. Из этих записок было известно, что после взрыва подводники из 7-го, 8-го отсека и какое-то время они там жили.
Only part of the letter is shown to the press. The other pages are kept secret. 12 bodies are brought up to the surface. The others remain imprisoned in the wreck until it is decided to raise the whole submarine. A ceremony is carried out in the presence of the members of the government, and then the bodies are kept for post-mortem. A few days later, a journalist from the newspaper Jizin quotes one of the forensic experts, Igor Gryaznov. He reveals that a second letter was found in Dmitry Kolesnikov's pocket, dated August 15th, 3 days after the tragedy. It is addressed to the head authorities and contains information on the accident. He adds that Vice Admiral Motsak had explicitly ordered them not to reveal its contents. The letter is never made public. This discovery brought to the foreground once more the idea that the sailors were perhaps left to die.
Семьи экипажа погибших на Курске и попросили представлять их интересы. Они признаны потерпевшими по уголовному делу.
Ordinary men and women decide to file a court case against the state. In Russia, this again is a precedent. And it may be this that convinces Putin to raise the wreck and the dead submariners.
Наш адвокат Борис Абрамович Кузнецов, значит, вот еще раз говорю, работает над делом сейчас. Тот, кто виноват, тот должен ответить за свои дела. А то у нас получается так, что-то случилось, а виноватых, как всегда, у нас нет.
The government finds a solution to raise the wreck, which will both conceal the causes of the tragedy and convince the public of Putin's goodwill. Many Russian and international companies make proposals to bring up the whole wreck, but these are rejected. Finally, the Dutch company, Mammoth, is chosen for the operation. It is the only one which refuses to raise the torpedo section. This is sawn off and left on the seabed, thus carefully avoiding the discovery of the Kursk's hidden secrets. The operation costs $130 million, double the yearly budget of the Russian Navy for the submarine fleet. This time, the whole of the international press is invited when the submarine, minus the front section, is finally raised to the surface. Hotel rooms, creation of websites, conference rooms, nothing is too grand for this impressive ceremony. During a posthumous ceremony to decorate the victims, Nadezhda Tilik takes the floor. She had already spoken out during the first meeting between the families and the officials and had been forcibly sedated.
Искренне жаль виновных в этой трагедии и тех людей, которых заставляли врать родным и близким погибших. Им придется нести в душе тяжкий груз и великий грех. Наберитесь мужества и покайтесь, пока еще не поздно.
The Dutch barge arrives, towing the Kursk. Little by little, the Tsar's emblem, the double-headed eagle emerges from the sea. It was ironically chosen for the Kursk to represent the rebirth of Russian supremacy. Vladimir Ustinov, the general prosecutor, the investigators, and the forensic experts board the submarine.
А что значит вот это отверстие на борту подводной лодки? Я видела его сама. Вмятина в борту внутрь и отверстие внутрь лодки.
I am surprised to see an obvious round hole in the Kursk's hull. It looks like a torpedo strike. It must be a torpedo strike. Something was happening that we still don't know about.
The side of the Kursk with the trace of the torpedo impact is quickly made out of bounds to cameras. Only 6 of the 24 missiles seem to have been slightly damaged by the explosion. Their nuclear heads are sent to be dismantled at a secret military base. According to some experts, the main reason for the recovery of the wreck was to avoid foreign fleets or terrorists from getting hold of information about the top secret missiles. The Russians finally admit that there were indeed nuclear warheads on board. All the bodies from the Kursk have been extricated from the wreck and autopsied. In order to minimize Putin's delay in accepting foreign assistance, Ustinov had officially announced that the majority of the crew were pulverized by the explosion and therefore could not have been saved. Yet only 3 out of 118 bodies could not be identified, and these were found in the torpedo compartment itself. The families of the victims will have waited 400 days to retrieve the bodies of their loved ones. Many feel the price they have paid to preserve a state secret is too high. This time, the press does not dare allude to the different responsibilities for the accident, whether they be Russian, American, or Chinese. Putin's aim for state control of the media has been achieved. The polls are there to prove it. He has gained 20% in popularity since meeting the families and the raising of the bodies. He is furious about the difficult situation his admirals had put him in by openly accusing the Americans in the Kursk affair. He fires 10 of them, 2 of whom are key figures, Popov and Motsak. Putin assures that no one is directly responsible, and the 2 admirals are given other comfortable functions. He now addresses the political question. Ilya Klebanov loses his position as vice prime minister, as do the minister of defense, Igor Sergeyev, and the home secretary. All those who had supported the idea of American responsibilities are struck down by Putin's lightning. The United States has been completely cleared of any responsibility, and Vladimir Putin can now openly pursue his allegiance with George W. Bush. At the end of 2002, Vladimir Ustinov makes the results of the official inquiry public. His report starts as follows, quote, "The disaster took place at 11:28 a.m. Moscow time due to a practice torpedo which set off a chain of explosions in the torpedo compartment, etc., etc." The 2,000-page report is full of contradictions and ends with the classic conclusion, dismissed for lack of evidence. The wreck of the Kursk is transported to a secret military island where it is dismantled and melted down. The Russian fleet blows up the remainder of the wreck, the torpedo section, which had been left on the sea floor. Any means of knowing the whole truth of the matter is now eradicated once and for all. Two monuments are erected in memory of the 118 deceased submarine crew members, one in Moscow and the other at its naval base in Vidyayevo. As for the families of the Kursk disaster, they are still waiting for the results of their vain court case against the state.
They were dealing with nuclear submarines, with dangerous weaponry, with exactly the kind of situation that could lead to some tragedy in the future. And for that reason alone, we need, in America, in Russia, globally, we need to know what really went on there. And if we can't find that out, then we are very far from being able to control the forces of militarism, of bureaucracy, the strongmen who want their kind of democracy that gets their results, whether it be George W. Bush in Florida, whether it be Putin and his attempt to kind of create the trappings of democracy without the substance in Moscow.
Наш сос все глуше, глуше, и ужас режет души напополам, и рвутся орды